Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
Students, this is Professor Ravin Zugade, and we were discussing about transition elements, which is a topic of inorganic chemistry. We were discussing about 3D series elements in special. The outline of the lecture is introduction to transition elements, position of periodic table, electronic configuration, atomic and ionic radii. These four topics we have covered in first lecture of this module. In this second lecture, we will be discussing about ionization potentials of 3D series elements and variable oxidation states of 3D series elements. This will be our lecture 2 module. And now we will concentrate on these two topics, starting with ionization potentials. How will you define ionization potential? It is the minimum amount of energy which is required to remove outermost electron from isolated gaseous atom in its ground state. It is sometimes called as ionization potential or ionization energy or ionization enthalpy. All the three terminologies mean the same. It is generally expressed in terms of kilojoule per mole or kilocalorie per mole, like that. Consider any atom. Now, if I want to remove electron from this atom, the most easily removable electrons are the outermost shell electrons, because they are the most loosely bound electrons. Each of these electrons is under the influence of attractive force from the nucleus. But since the distance of the outermost shell electron is maximum, the force of attraction between nucleus and outermost electron is minimum. And hence, if I supply some energy to this electron, I can remove this electron. And that energy is called as the ionization potential or ionization enthalpy. For this, if I supply an energy equal to E1 and the electron is removed, then that energy is called as first ionization potential or first ionization energy. Once the electron is gone, the atom becomes a positively charged ion, that is now cation. Now, if I want to remove the second electron from here, I will have to supply some energy again, and it is not same as the first one. This is, say, E2 amount of energy is supplied, and the electron is removed from the outermost shell. Now, the atom will acquire dipositive charges. If I want to remove third electron from here, again I will have to supply some energy, called as the third ionization enthalpy or third ionization potential. Now, first electron is going from an isolated gaseous atom, and as a result, the energy required is minimum. The second ionization enthalpy or second ionization potential is higher than that. The third ionization potential is higher than that. It means that in general, the trend of ionization potential is first IP less than second IP less than third IP. There are a few factors which govern ionization potentials. The first factor is nuclear charge. Now, if the nuclear charge is more or nuclear charge is increased, then the force of attraction between nucleus and the outermost electron will increase. And so, if we want to remove that electron, we will have to supply more energy. In other words, with increase in nuclear charge, the ionization potential goes on increasing. Or the ionization potential is directly proportional to nuclear charge. Second factor which governs the ionization potential is the number of shells. If the number of shells are more, then the force of attraction between nucleus and outermost electron is less. Quite obvious, because if the number of shells are more, then the outermost electron will experience less force of attraction from the nucleus. In other words, ionization potential is inversely proportional to number of shells. Third factor is the shielding effect. Now, in the last class, we have discussed what is shielding effect. Shielding effect is the reduction in the force of attraction between the outermost electron and the nucleus because of the inner shell electrons present between the outer electron and the nucleus. This effect is called as shielding effect or screening effect. Now, the function of screening effect or function of the shielding effect is to reduce the nuclear force of attraction. And hence, if the shielding effect increases, ionization potential decreases. And the fourth factor which governs the ionization potential is atomic size. Quite obvious, if the atom is small in size, the force of attraction between nucleus and electron is large, and so removal of electron becomes difficult. As a result, we can say if atomic size increases, ionization potential decreases. So an inverse proportion exists between the two. Now, what happens in case of periodic table? When we move from left to right in a periodic table, since the nuclear charge is continuously increasing and atomic radius is decreasing, as a result, the ionization potential goes on increasing from left to right across any period in general. What happens in case of 3D series elements? You will find there are two ionization potentials we have presented over here. The first ionization potential values and second ionization potential values. They are presented in kilojoule per mole. From scandium to zinc, atomic number 21 to atomic number 30. We will see what are the important observations regarding this. Now, if you see the values of these ionization potentials, they are of the order of 600 to 800 kilojoule per mole. Now, these values are exactly between the S and P block elements. S block elements have lower ionization potentials than this. P block elements have higher ionization potentials than this. Secondly, if you see the second ionization potential values, they are of the order of 1200 to 1400 kilojoule per mole. So almost double as compared to the first ionization potentials. Quite obvious, because more energy is required to remove an electron from cation as compared to gaseous atom. Third important observation is the rate of increase of ionization potential. You will find that the ionization potential is increasing here, but the rate of increase is much less. Let us compare this with the S block elements. See the values of ionization potentials in kilojoule per mole for potassium, calcium, scandium, titanium up to zinc. See, when you go from potassium to calcium, see the increase in ionization potential value. 419 to 590. An increase of about 171 kilojoule in a single atomic number. When you go from scandium to titanium, the increase is just 27 kilojoule per mole. It means that there is only a small increase in ionization potential from scandium to titanium. From titanium to vanadium, slight decrease, you can say almost constant. From vanadium to chromium, again almost constant. So almost constant ionization potential from scandium to chromium, 631 to 653. Large increase in case of S block element, negligible increase in case of the D block elements. Okay, then after that, there is slight increase from chromium to copper and large increase in zinc. Let us try to explain this. If we consider what is the ionization potential, it is the amount of energy required to remove electron from the outermost shell. As a result, we want to remove the electron from 4s subshell. So this electron is to be removed. Whereas after calcium, when you go to scandium, the added electron goes to third shell, that is the 3d subshell. The nuclear charge is increased by one unit and electron is added to the penultimate shell or last but one shell. Next electron is again added to last but one shell. Third electron again added to the penultimate shell. Fourth electron again added to the penultimate shell. Now two things are taking place. The nuclear charge is increasing, thereby the force of attraction between the nucleus and outermost electron should increase. But at the same time, since electrons are added to penultimate shell, the shielding effect is also increasing. And since the shielding effect is increasing continuously in each element, there is a compensation of nuclear force and shielding effect. And since they are compensated, the ionization potential remains almost constant from scandium to chromium and slightly increase from chromium to copper. In case of copper and in case of zinc, now the electrons are added and inter-electronic repulsion we have discussed already in the last class, and because of this the atomic radius increases. Also, the ionization potential also increases in case of zinc. That we will see. Now, this reason lies in the electronic configuration of zinc. You will find that the electron has to go from 4s subshell, whereas the 3d is completely filled. Now, this configuration is also called as the pseudo inert gas configuration. What is the inert gas configuration? NS2 NP6. Whereas what is pseudo inert gas configuration is NS2 NP6 ND10. So it means that the electron has to go from extra stable configuration, and as a result the ionization potential of zinc is higher than expected. Coming to the second ionization potentials, now you will find there are two humps over here. That is, the ionization potentials of chromium and copper are higher than expected, or they are higher than their successors, manganese and zinc. The reason again lies in the electronic configuration of these two elements. When the first electron is lost from chromium, it has got 5d5, the extra stable configuration, and hence removal of electron from this extra stable configuration is difficult. Same is the case with copper. When one electron is lost, for second ionization potential we will have to remove the second electron, and second electron has to go from 3d10 configuration, which is again extra stable. So removal of electron from extra stable configuration is difficult, requires more energy, and hence second ionization potentials of chromium and copper are higher than the corresponding elements. Oxidation states of these elements, another periodic property or another property of these 3d series elements. What is oxidation state? It is the number of electrons which are lost or gained by an atom during formation of a compound. So if the electrons are lost, we say that oxidation state is positive. If electrons are gained, the oxidation state is said to be negative. Now, all the metals have low ionization potentials. Now these 3d series elements are also metals, and since their ionization potentials or ionization enthalpies are low, it's easy to remove electron, and they have a tendency to lose electrons and show positive oxidation states. Consider the example of S block elements. Alkali metals and alkaline earth metals. Lithium, sodium, potassium, rubidium, cesium. They show only plus 1 oxidation state. Alkaline earth metals, beryllium, magnesium, calcium, strontium, barium, they show only plus 2 oxidation state. It means that the S block elements are showing positive oxidation state, but no variable oxidation state, but a single oxidation state. When we come to 3D series elements, then important property of 3D series elements is variable oxidation state. You will find scandium is showing two different oxidation state, plus 2, plus 3. Titanium, plus 2, plus 3, plus 4. Vanadium, plus 2, plus 3, plus 4, plus 5. Chromium, up to plus 6. Manganese, up to plus 7. So you will find large number of oxidation states are shown by these elements. Now, why these elements are showing these many oxidation states? The reason lies again in the electronic configuration. The electronic configuration is such that the energies of 3D and 4S energy levels are very close to each other. So, removal of electron from 4S as well as 3D is easily possible. And so, these elements have a tendency to release electrons either from 4S only or 4S electrons followed by the 3D electrons. So they can lose electrons from 4S as well as 3D subshells. Now we will discuss some important properties of these variable oxidation states. What is the minimum oxidation state in all these elements? You will find that the minimum oxidation state is either plus 2 or plus 1. Most of the elements are showing plus 2 as minimum oxidation state, while only chromium and copper, they are showing plus 1 as minimum oxidation state. What is the reason for this? Again, the reason lies in the electronic configuration. Chromium has 4s1 configuration. Similarly, copper has 4s1 configuration. So by losing the electrons from 4s, they can show plus 1 oxidation state. In general, we can make a statement that the minimum oxidation state is equal to number of electrons which are present in 4s subshell. What is the maximum oxidation state? We will find that the maximum oxidation state continuously goes on increasing from scandium plus 3 to manganese plus 7. You can correlate this maximum oxidation state with the electronic configuration again. You will find that the maximum oxidation state of scandium is plus 3 because it can lose electrons from 4s plus 3d. So total number of electrons in 4s plus 3d is equal to 3. Similarly, titanium has 4 electrons over here. Vanadium has 5 electrons. Chromium has 6 electrons. Manganese has 7 electrons. But iron is having 8 electrons and showing only up to plus 6 oxidation state. Now, what is the reason? From iron onwards, you will find that the higher oxidation states are lost. The reason is, when we go across the period from scandium to zinc, we know that the ionization potential is continuously increasing. And since ionization potential increases, more amount of energy is required to remove the electrons. Hence, by the time we reach iron, the ionization potential has come to such a value that removal of more number of electrons becomes more and more difficult. Hence, iron onwards, the higher oxidation state are not shown by the elements. Hence, the maximum oxidation state goes on decreasing from manganese to zinc. Now, apart from these oxidation states which are shown in this table, some elements have a tendency to show even the zero oxidation state, will find the compounds like NiCO4, FeCO5, CrCO6, the metal carbonyls. These metal carbonyls have the metal in zero oxidation state. Carbonyl is a very strong ligand and it is a neutral ligand. So you will find that this nickel, iron and chromium are showing zero oxidation state in their respective carbonyls. Let us compare the stability of the oxidation states. Scandium is showing +2 and +3 oxidation state. Now which is more stable among them? In scandium +3, there is a D0 configuration because +3 oxidation state is formed by loss of 4s and 3d electrons, and +3 oxidation state will have argon electronic configuration, which is a noble gas configuration. Similarly, titanium 4+ and titanium 3+. Titanium 4+ will be more stable because all the electrons from 4s and 3d are lost now and it gets the noble gas configuration. One more important property of zinc in this series is that zinc is the only element which is showing single oxidation state. Again, the reason of zinc lies in its electronic configuration, because once it loses these two electrons from 4s, it is having 3d10 configuration, which is completely filled extra stable configuration. So removal of electron from extra stable configuration is difficult, and hence zinc shows only +2 oxidation state. Now when a compound is formed in different oxidation state, the properties of the compound goes on changing. Take an example. Manganese forms three types of oxides: MnO in +2 oxidation state, MnO2 in +4 oxidation state, and Mn2O7 in +7 oxidation state. Now this MnO is distinctly basic in nature. MnO2 is amphoteric, showing both the properties of acidic as well as basic oxides, and Mn2O7 is acidic in nature. Now what is the reason for this? The reason lies in the charge on the metal ion. If you see this, Mn is in +2 oxidation state. Now Mn+2 and O2 negative, they are forming a compound MnO. Now this manganese is having its own polarizing power. You have Mn4+ will have higher polarizing power, and Mn+7 will have still higher polarizing power. And more is the polarizing power of the cation, more is the polarization, and hence more is the covalent character of the compound. Now from MnO to MnO2 to Mn2O7, when we move with increase in oxidation state of the metal, the covalent character goes on increasing, the ionic character goes on decreasing, and so the compound becomes more and more acidic with increase in the oxidation state. Let us talk about the redox stability of the metals. Now these metal ions, when they exist in aqueous solution or in the solution state, they have different stabilities. Some of them are more stable, some of them are less stable. So the relative tendency to undergo change in the oxidation state is called as the redox stability. And stability of these various oxidation states can be expressed in terms of their redox potential or reduction potential or electrode potentials, as IUPAC system says. The species with higher reduction potential will have a tendency to undergo reduction, and the species which is having higher oxidation potential will have a tendency to undergo oxidation. And the redox stability can be expressed in terms of three types of diagrams which are normally used in redox systems: the Latimer diagram, Froese diagram, or Purbe diagram. We'll see the important features of Latimer diagram. We'll discuss Latimer diagrams of certain elements. The first one is manganese. Now what is Latimer diagram? It is a diagrammatic representation of all the oxidation states, starting from highest oxidation state on left hand side to the lowest oxidation state on right hand side. See an example. This is the Latimer diagram of manganese. You will find that this manganese is shown in various oxidation states like plus 7, plus 6, plus 4, plus 3, plus 2, and 0. These are the species which are present in this particular condition, like MnO4 negative, MnO42 negative, MnO2, Mn3 positive ion, Mn2 positive ion, and elemental manganese. And you will find that there are arrows in between each two species, and some value is written over these arrows. This is the reduction potential of this system of conversion of Mn7 positive to Mn6 positive. This is a reduction potential, or in general we call it as a electrode potential of MnO4 negative, MnO42 negative system. Now, if this value of reduction potential is positive, then this process is feasible in the forward direction. If it is negative, it is not feasible in the forward direction. It means that if you have Mn in the 7 positive state and Mn in the 6 positive state, since the value of the reduction potential is positive, Mn7 positive will have a tendency to undergo conversion from plus 7 state to plus 6 state by gaining one electron. We will discuss some more properties of this particular Latimer diagram of manganese. So what we can observe, if you see from plus 7 to plus 2 oxidation state, all the reduction potentials have positive values. 0.56 positive, plus 2.26 positive, this value is again positive, this value is again positive. It indicates that the reduction is feasible up to Mn2 positive. But when you go to Mn2 positive conversion to Mn, the reduction potential is negative, indicating that the process of reduction of manganese 2 plus to Mn0 is not feasible, indicating that Mn2 plus is the most stable species among all of them. This can be expressed also in terms of a Frost diagram. If we convert this Latimer diagram into Frost diagram, you will find this Frost diagram is a graph between oxidation state and N into E0 value. N is the number of the oxidation state, that is number of electrons lost or gained, and multiplied by the E0 value, it is the standard reduction potential with respect to zero oxidation state. Which is the most stable oxidation state? The one which is having lowest value of N into E0, which is plus 2 oxidation state in manganese. This is quite obvious because we can find a large number of compounds of manganese like MnCl2, MnSO4, MnCO3. They exist in nature and all of them contain manganese in plus 2 oxidation state. These are very common compounds of manganese. Coming to the Latimer diagram of iron. Now, iron is existing in the form of plus 6, plus 3, plus 2 and 0 oxidation state. This is a Latimer diagram in acidic medium. These are the reduction potentials. You will find these two reduction potentials are positive. It means that conversion of plus 6 to plus 3 and plus 3 to plus 2 oxidation state are feasible, whereas plus 2 to 0 is non-spontaneous process because the reduction potential over here is negative. So plus 6 to plus 3 and plus 3 to plus 2 are favorable, but plus 2 to elemental state is unfavorable. So you can say that Fe2 plus is the most stable compound in acidic medium. If we convert it into Frost diagram, you will find that plus 2 oxidation state is having minimum value of N into E0, indicating that it is the most stable species of iron in acidic medium. But if we come to the basic medium, there is a fundamental difference. The species have now changed. You have plus 6 oxidation state, plus 3 and plus 2 and 0. But now the reduction potential over here is negative. Here is also negative. This is positive. It means that the most stable oxidation state will be plus 3 and not the plus 2. In acidic medium, plus 2 is the most stable oxidation state. In basic medium, plus 3 is the most stable oxidation state. Now if we compare again with the Froese diagram, you will find that here for plus 3 oxidation state, N into E0 value is minimum, and so it is the most stable oxidation state. Coming to the Latimer diagram of copper. Now copper exists in plus 2, plus 1 and 0 oxidation state. Both the reduction potentials are positive. It means that Cu2 plus has a strong tendency to get converted to Cu positive, and Cu positive also has a strong tendency to get converted into Cu elemental. Means that elemental copper is the most stable species. As shown by the Froese diagram also, the zero oxidation state has got minimum value of N into E0. So this will be the most stable species of copper. Remaining portion of this topic we will discuss in the next lecture, lecture 3. Thank you.